Hello, I'm Dr. Marla Shapiro. I'm a past president of the North American Menopause Society, and I'm joined today by Dr. Gloria Richard Davis, who is the Executive Director for Division of Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion, and professor in the Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology at the University of Arkansas Medical Science. She serves as Division Director, Reproductive Endocrinology and Infertility, and as well as the Medical Director for the Physician Assistant Program. As well, she sat on the board of trustees of the North American Menopause Society. One busy lady, thank you for joining us today.
Thanks so much, Marla. Pleasure to be here.
So, Gloria, there are so many preparations that are out on the market, and as women are you know, slowly coming back to recognize that there are safe treatment options for menopause and away from those headline news back in the early 2000s, given the number of options and preparations, it can be confusing for women. Is there some sort of guidance that women as patients can understand to be able to have an informed conversation with their healthcare practitioner?
Yeah. I'm glad you started with there are safe options, because obviously that's where we start the conversation with patients. And really taking a history from a personal and from a family perspective to inquire about whether or not there are any contraindications, any risk associated with whether or not they can use these preparations, right? Then we really kind of drill down to what kind of symptoms are they having? I tend to use the menopausal rated scale questionnaire so that I have a pretty comprehensive idea of what patients are experiencing. Because oftentimes they might come in saying they're having hot flushes, but they don't acknowledge some of the other symptoms that they're having, right? So that helps me to get a global view of what symptoms are we dealing with. And then it is considerations of sort of the more personal issues of what kinds of preparations are they comfortable using. There are some patients who are not consistent with taking pills. You know, they forget. And perhaps in those patients, they may want to consider a transdermal option if we're talking about systemic. And then, of course, for those patients who still have their uterus, then we have to talk about the progestin, the combination preparation, and the progestin component that's critical to protect their endometrium, you know, to prevent endometrial cancer. And so there's a discussion about progestin component, whether it's synthetic or micronized progestins. And lastly is the local preparations, where we have, again, a number of different options there. So taking the patient's preference into consideration, we have, you know, creams, inserts, rings. So there are lots of options. And I would certainly advise the patients to know those, you know, have a general idea of what those options are, so that when they go into their physician's office, they can, you know, help to direct where they might be better served. And also to know sort of the potential downside of or risk of using hormone therapy, if they have any. I mean, most of our patients who are recently menopausal, they're healthy, there's really no reason why they can't use hormone therapy.
So if I'm coming to you and I'm aware that there's either a gel that I can use or a patch or something that I can take by mouth, how would I know, if I don't have a preference, whether one would be safer for me versus another? What questions should I be asking, or what advice should I be looking for?
Well, the first thing I would say is that they are all safe, right? I mean, the preparations that are on the market that's FDA approved have gone through rigorous clinical trials. And so I think I'd want to make sure that the patient's concern in terms of safety is alleviated, right? And then from there, then we talk about the oral preparations versus, let's say, transdermal, and I'll leave local out of that, right? But with the oral preparation versus transdermal, there are some theoretical benefits of the transdermal, where it does not go through a first pass of the liver. And by that, we mean that there are some metrics or measurements that looks at coagulation factors, right? Is there an increase in coagulation by using hormone therapy? Is there an increase in thromboembolic events?
Meaning a blood clot.
Any blood clots, right. So in theory, the transdermal preparation may have a lower risk of that. But again, we have no head-to-head comparisons of oral versus transdermal. So both are safe.
Now, I'm a woman who's not having hot flashes or night sweats at all. Should I be thinking about hormone therapy?
If you're not symptomatic, you don't necessarily need hormone therapy. The indication for anything that we use systemically is bothersome, right? They have to be symptomatic enough for the indication. If you're having just local symptoms, you may not need systemic medications. You need something that acts locally.
So let's talk about that. There are all these different local options and even a pill that I've heard as a woman you can take if you've got, you know, troublesome symptoms of either a dry vagina or pain with intercourse or without intercourse, discharge, irritation. What should women be thinking about in that case? And is the safety issue the same? Because they all come with this warning, no matter what type of estrogen you're taking.
Absolutely. And obviously that's been a concern for us because they are not the same. When you talk about vaginal preparation, you have very little systemic absorption. It acts locally. And so when we look at the options of whether it's a cream or a ring or an insert, they all potentially act the same. They improve the vaginal mucosa. They thicken it, which is the biggest problem with the dryness and the pain with intercourse, right? It's trying to restore normal mucosa. And so they're all very effective in doing that. There are a couple of preparations that are somewhat different, and that is the vaginal DHEA, the progesterone, which is a non-estrogen product. And for some women who have that concern, even though when we talk about vaginal preparation, they really shouldn't, but it's a non-estrogen preparation that gets converted to estrogen and androgen in the vaginal mucosa. And there are some theoretical benefits. You know, we have some publications to suggest that there may be an improvement in sexual desire with the use of that particular preparation. So we're beginning to study that. We need more information on it. And I'm beginning to look at that in breast cancer survivors. So we're excited about doing that.
Because often for breast cancer survivors, there's so little that we do have to offer them. So we really are looking forward to that as a community of women. The last question I want to ask you is, if I come to see you and I want you to give me something that's just for me, will you do my blood hormone level so you can make something just for me?
There really is not a reason to do blood hormone levels. We know that when we treat women and their symptoms are alleviated, it doesn't matter. You don't need to measure hormones. There are very few instances where I feel like it's even helpful, right? Otherwise, it's just an unnecessary expense and bothersome for them. If we have someone who is, or we have a patient who is not responding the way that we think she should, my concern is she not absorbing the preparation the way that she should? And so in those instances, I may order, you know, hormonal levels, but that's probably the only exception that I can think of.
And is there enough on the market where you can tell a woman in general that I can individualize your treatment by using something that's FDA approved or Health Canada approved for our Canadian viewership?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, we have just a huge number of options. We talked about, you know, the varying routes of preparation, the dosing variation, as well as the route. So I think you can very comfortably come up with an option for a woman that meets all of her needs and is safe.
And on that word of safety, I will thank you for your time. Thanks so much, Gloria. It's been great being with you.
Oh, thank you.